Plants are so unlike people that it's very difficult for us to appreciate fully their complexity and sophistication. Yet, plants have been evolving for much, much longer than we have been inventing new strategies for survival and perfecting their designs for so long that to say that one of us is the more advanced really depends on how you define that term, on what advances you value. Naturally, we value abilities such as consciousness, tool making, and language, if only because these have been the destinations of our own evolutionary journey thus far. Plants have traveled all that distance and then some. They have just traveled in a different direction. Plants are nature's alchemists, experts at transforming water, soil, and sunlight into an array of precious substances, many of them beyond the ability of human beings to conceive, much less manufacture. While we were nailing down consciousness and learning to walk on 2 feet, they were, by the same process of natural selection, inventing photosynthesis, the astonishing trick of converting sunlight into food, and perfecting organic chemistry. As it turns out, many of the plant's discoveries in chemistry and physics have served us well. From plants come chemical compounds that nourish, heal, poison, and delight the senses. Others that rouse, put to sleep, and intoxicate. And a few with the astounding power to alter consciousness, even to plant dreams in the brains of awake humans. Why would they go to all this trouble? Why should plants bother to devise the recipes for so many complex molecules and then expend the energy needed to manufacture them. One important reason is defense. A great many of the chemicals plants produce are designed by natural selection to compel other creatures to leave them alone. Deadly poisons, foul flavors, toxins to confound the minds of predators. But many other of the substances plants make have exactly the opposite effect, drawing other creatures to them by stirring and gratifying their desires. The same great existential fact of plant life explains why plants make chemicals to both repel and attract other species. Immobility. The one thing plants can't do is move, or to be more precise, locomote. Plants can't escape the creatures that prey on them. They also can't change location or extend their range without help. And so, about 100 million years ago, plants stumbled on a way, actually a few thousand different ways, of getting animals, wind, or water to carry them and their genes here and there. This was the evolutionary watershed associated with the advent of the angiosperms, an extraordinary new class of plants that made showy flowers and formed large fruits with seeds that other species were induced to disseminate, to spread widely, sowing their seeds. Plants began evolving burrs that attach to animal fur like Velcro. Flowers that seduce bees in order to powder their thighs with pollen, and acorns that squirrels obligingly taxi from one forest to another, bury, and then, just often enough, forget to eat. Even evolution evolves. About 10,000 years ago, the world witnessed a second flowering of plant diversity that we could come to call, somewhat self-centeredly, the invention of agriculture. A group of angiosperms, flowering plants, refines their basic put the animals to work strategy to take advantage of one particular animal that had developed not only to move freely around the earth, but to think and trade complicated thoughts. these plans hid a remarkably clever strategy, getting us to move and think for them. Now came edible grasses such as wheat and corn that incited humans to cut down vast forests to make more room for them. Flowers whose beauty would transfix whole cultures. Plants so compelling and useful and tasty, they would inspire human beings to see, transport, extol, and even write books, poems, and songs about them. Am I hereby suggesting that plants made me do it? Only in the sense that the flower makes the bee pay it a visit. Evolution doesn't depend on the will or intention to work. It is almost by definition an unconscious, unwilled process. All it requires are beings compelled, as all plants and animals are, to make more of themselves by whatever means. Is so clever, it appears purposeful. The act that cultivates its own gardens of edible fungus, for instance, or the pitcher plant that convinces a fly it's a piece of rotten meat. But such traits are clever only in retrospect. Design in nature is but a concatenation of accidents, a series of interconnected or interdependent events, trials and errors, until the result is so beautiful or effective as to seem a miracle of purpose. By the same token, we are prone to overestimate our own agency in nature. Many of the activities humans like to think they undertake for their own good purposes. Inventing agriculture, outlawing certain plants, writing books, words, and music in praise of others are mere contingencies as far as nature is concerned. Our desires are simply more grist for evolution's mill, no different from a change in the weather, a peril for some species, an opportunity for others. Our grammar might teach us to divide the world into active subjects and passive objects. But in co-evolution, we Something the grasses did.